In 1921, Dr. William Henry Griffith Thomas, outstanding Anglican scholar and professor of Old Testament exegesis at Wycliffe College in Toronto, Canada, met with Dr. Lewis Sperry Chafer to consider and pray about the creating of a new seminary. In 1924, those prayers were answered in the Evangelical Theological College, later to be called Dallas Theological Seminary, was birthed. Unfortunately, W.H. Griffith Thomas died that same year before he could come and be a part of the founding of the school. But the lectureship that we begin this week is a memorial to his commitment and the ideals of Dallas Theological Seminary. Each year, qualified lecturers are selected alternately by each of the divisions of our seminary, biblical studies, theological studies, and the Division of Ministry and Communications. The lectures consist of a presentation of scholarly papers on topics not normally covered in the seminary curriculum or at the same depth. This year, our speaker was selected by the Department of Bible Exposition in the Biblical Studies Division, and our annual lectures are generally published in our journal, Bibliotheca Sacra, our quarterly theological journal. Over the years, many notable scholars have presented these lectures, men such as Harry A. Ironside, Dr. Frank Gabelein, Francis Schaeffer, J.I. Packer, F.F. Bruce, Bruce Metzger. This year, it's our privilege to hear from Dr. Walt Kaiser, who continues that excellent tradition. Dr. Walter C. Kaiser, Jr., President Emeritus at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary in Massachusetts, is an evangelical speaker who holds to the truths that the Bible is the inspired and inerrant Word of God. He uses hermeneutics rooted in the grammatical historical methods and teaches what he has called promise theology using expository preaching methods that focus on the meaning and messages of the biblical text, especially that of the Old Testament. His love of the Lord Jesus Christ, his knowledge of the whole of the biblical text, and a God-given sense of humor that you will hear make Dr. Kaiser a sought-after evangelical speaker and Christian author. I can't tell you how many books he's authored. He just gave me a new one this weekend. When he isn't traveling and he isn't speaking, he's found on his farm in Wisconsin. Having grown up on a farm in Pennsylvania, he loves the farm life. He's an avid gardener and enjoys spending his free time on the tractor. Walt shares his home with two of his children, his son-in-law, and five of his grandchildren. And to add to the excitement of family life farm, he enjoys watching his son-in-law and daughters-in-law llama herd, the llama herd that they have. His, as he called her, his girlfriend of so many years is now with the Lord. But when I first became president at Dallas Seminary and attended my first Fellowship of Evangelical Seminary President's meeting, it was Walt Kaiser and his wife Marge who reached out to Barbie and me. And it has been a great friendship over the years since then. We have the privilege of serving together on the Board of Bible Study Fellowship, and we just spent 5 days together in Southern California at board meetings. And so it is a tremendous personal privilege to have Dr. Walt Kaiser with us today. Would you join me in welcoming my friend and our lecturer, Dr. Walt Kaiser?
Good morning to each one of you, and greetings in the name of our wonderful Lord. After he read that list of speakers, it reminded me of one of those quizzes, which one does not fit? Well, we've felt with delight every blessing God has brought to you. And it is a joy to be in the fellowship and join together with you in the great prospect of seeing the name of our Lord Jesus lifted up. He is coming very, very soon. I don't know exactly when. I should tell you right off that I am not a prophet. I don't have the gift of prophecy. And My father wasn't a prophet either. He was a farmer, so I'm not a son of a prophet. And I've worked all these years for a nonprofit organization. Can't spell either. At any rate, in these lectures, I want to address our work together on the Book of Psalms. I was introduced this year to one of our men from Australia, O. Palmer Robertson, The Flow of the Psalms, Discovering Their Structure and Theology. And they asked me to write the foreword for the book. Well, I was delighted to do so, but found a whole new area of study. So our lectures is going to focus on book three, which is at the heart of the five books of the Psalms. And we're beginning today by talking about the using the context of the whole Psalter, the whole book of Psalms, as an aid to interpreting the book. So let me get right into it. It is rather unusual to find in recent biblical commentary and exegesis of individual Psalms any reference to the broader context of the whole book within the message and the plan of the Book of Psalms. It is all too frequently assumed that each psalm stands on its own and usually is isolated from any literary or theological connection with the whole book of Psalms that's around it. However, in recent psalm studies, a new emphasis is being placed on the broader contextual connections of also interpreting the individual psalm in its context of the whole book of Psalms. This is a new development, and it's a welcome addition to our treatment of this book of 150 chapters, which is probably written over a span of 500 years at least. A major impetus in such holistic contextual reading of the psalm and its setting within the Psalter is the recent book, as I just mentioned to you, The Flow of the Psalms, Discovering the Structure and the Theology by O. Palmer Robertson. Despite overt and almost universal skepticism over the past centuries of biblical exposition about ever bringing any significant order or an intentional structure into the five books of the Psalter, many biblical scholars have substituted modern form critical approaches to the Psalms that look for the meaning of the psalm, not in the context, as we generally do with every other book, but instead a meaning that is sought in a way the various psalm genres relate to cultural and social circumstances of the times they were written in. A good illustration of this type of substitution of cultural circumstances in place of using the whole context of the book can be found in the work of an evangelical Old Testament scholar, John Goldingay. He observed, quote, "The Psalter as a whole does not have a structure that helps to get at a handle on its contents." So he would give the opposite lecture what I would give here today. But we are praying that he would listen. Do you love to tease? You should smile in the pulpit. Yeah. I have learned that in teaching, if you say it with a smile, it goes down. But if someone raises their hand, what was the second word? I didn't get the first clause, you know. Would you repeat that again? And then the final question, will this be on the test? Don't put it on the test. You will forget your calling. Well, at any rate, Robertson raised the question, is there such a thing as a plan or purpose, a flow in the Book of Psalms? Robertson knows that his is a minority voice, for there is no end of discouragement heaped on those who've attempted to analyze the Psalms to see if there were an intentional development of order or an ongoing coherent theme in these 150 chapters. One exception to this general pessimistic prospect of ever finding an overall intentional structure to the Psalms is the contribution of John Walton. He investigated the content of the Psalms, arguing that the content would function as a major key in detecting the structure of the Psalter as it was placed alongside of the Davidic covenant. But Walton, as had Robertson, had chosen an impossible task in view of most scholars. For even the great evangelical scholar, one of my favorites, Franz Delitzsch, back in the 19th century, had warned after reviewing the attempt of the church father, Gregory Nyssa, to show that the five books of the Psalms lead upward in five steps of moral perfection. Actually, he was on the right track, but with the wrong idea. So we fear that in this direction, investigation has set before itself an unattainable end. That was view, I should have told you quotes around that, of Franz Delitzsch. Well, nevertheless, Robertson plunged ahead in his quest to identify the intentional structure of the Psalms. He began by making Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 the two poetic pillars that were taken together and would anticipate the major themes that occupy the five books found in the Psalter. First of all, Psalm 1 traces the downward slope of the ungodly, but a different way of life marks the identity of the righteous, for they love the word and law of God. To this emphasis can be added the Torah Psalms of Psalm 19 and 119, further, which demonstrated the centrality of the teaching, which is probably the best translation of Torah, the teaching of the Word of God. But there was a second major theme found in two poetic pillars of Psalm 1 and 2. It is the centrality of the person of the Messiah. Yahweh had established the presence of the Messianic King in Zion, from which he would rule and reign over the nations of the world. Herein, Robertson argued, was to be found in these two poetic pillars, Psalm 1, Psalm 2, the overarching message of the Psalter. In all, Robertson thought that at least 12 different elements could be identified in this basic structure of the Psalms. But without going into the details at this moment, the Psalter helps us to view that they were not psalms that were helter-skelter, discombobulated assembly of various contributions that were detached from one another, only linked together by their genres, some lament, some thanksgiving, etc., etc. Robertson was careful not to give the impression that the Psalter could be treated as if it were a theological treatise that was setting forth its theme in a predetermined logical order. After all, this was a collection of 150 psalms, as I said, that spanned 500 years and did not claim to be the work of a single person or group of persons. However, lest too much be made of that argument, recall that the entire Bible is composed of 66 books, authors who lived on three continents, Africa, Asia, and Europe, and spoke in three languages, and yet the Bible has one continuous story and promised plan from start to finish. What then was the intentional structure of these 150 Psalms? Would that structure yield a cohesive progress in the purpose and the plan of God? But before examining this concept any further, let us begin by analyzing the two giant pillars of Psalm 1 and Psalm 2. As already been affirmed, Psalm 1 and 2 are not only the, quote, introductory psalms to the whole Psalter, they are, quote, foundational to the whole book of the Psalter, in that when taken together, they define the substance of all that's going to follow. And so Psalm 1 lays out the critical role of the teaching or the law of God, while Psalm 2 presents the Davidic son who is appointed by our Lord to have a kingdom that will eventually extend to the ends of the earth. The two themes would be Torah and Messiah, or to put in other words, law and gospel. Or to describe the role of the two Psalms in an altogether different manner, Psalm 1 identifies two groups of people in relation to God and his instructions. The wicked, who despise God's teaching, and the righteous, who delight in his word. Moreover, the righteous are like a tree that is fed, you remember, by a stream nearby, which therefore brings forth fruit in its season. Contrarywise, the wicked are like dried up chaff that can be blown away. For when all is said and done, the wicked will perish and will be left outside the group of the people of God. Meanwhile, the righteous will be vindicated by the Lord and will be known as his own. Robertson argued that the other poetic pillar was Psalm 2, which had four major themes that came from the Davidic covenant. I was asked to go to Romania on the spur of the moment while Ceausescu was still in the power. And my wife and I were with team missionaries in France. Someone found that out and said, do you have any time off? Well, I'm a workaholic and I don't take time off. But this time I listened to my wife. We had these days set aside for a little touring. And he said, that's good, you can do that some other time. This was an airline pilot whom I didn't know. He said, you go to Romania. I said, but you need a visa to get in there. He said, don't get it. It will tell them you're coming. This is like in Boston, where you don't use turn signals because it gives away what you're going to do. So, at any rate, we had quite an experience there, but how hungry the people were for hearing the teaching of the Word of God. So they told me, teach the whole Old Testament from 5 o'clock till 10 o'clock. The whole thing. With an interrupter. Well, interpreter. So I don't know if you ever had one of those moments, but I thought, wait a minute. There are four mountain peaks in the whole Old Testament. There is Genesis 3:15, the covenant God gave to Eve. I said that seed was gonna crush the head of the serpent, always with the article, Hanachash, the serpent, and bam, which is generally bad. If you work in the ER, emergency room, Pancake skulls are very difficult to deal with. Very, well, I'll let you figure that out. But at any rate, then I said there was Abraham, and God gave him word, in your seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Everybody, you are to be a channel. You are to be the conduit. And then I said there was 2 Samuel 7. God gave a word to David that he would give him a throne and a dynasty and a crown forever and ever and ever. I always get stuck on that word. And ever and ever. David went in the house of God, sat down, like you're going to sit in the new chapel, and just sat down and said, oy vey. That's a marginal reading. My Bible has wide margins. So at any rate, he said, oh Lord, who am I? And who is my family? I come from, you know, Hicktown, Bethlehem. I tend to sheep and goats, not people. And he said, and this that you just told me is the Torah Ha'adam, v'zot Torah Ha'adam, and this is the instruction, the law for humanity, which up until last 2 years ago, none of the translations got it right. Matter of fact, I even was responsible for the NIV in 2 Samuel. I didn't turn that in. I turned in, this is the charter for humanity. And they put, for three Hebrew words, v'zot Torah Ha'adam, is this your usual way of dealing with man? Whoa! These guys are being super generous. Seven words for three. Well, at any rate, that's another story. I'll just share my prayer request with you. But here's 2 Samuel 7. 2 Samuel, here he brings four themes he finds in Psalm 2. Psalm 2 stressed the kingship of David over all the nations, thereby rebelling against the Lord's kingship was an exercise in futility. The Lord's kingship was found throughout each of the five books in the Psalter. Two. Psalm 2 declared that the locale of the Lord's rule would be, where? In Zion of Jerusalem. Even though the Lord is enthroned in heaven, chapter 2, verse 4 of Psalms, yet the site for the rule of God is often mentioned as being in Jerusalem. Though this duality seemed to be present an unresolved problem, yet once again in 2 Samuel 7:13, he made it clear that David and his offspring would build a house for the Lord. Where? In Jerusalem, Zion. Third, Psalm 2 clearly pointed to the fact that the Lord would permanently establish David and his dynasty. The theme is repeated and amplified in all five books of the Psalter, except book 4. There's a reason. Finally, Psalm 2 describes the merger of the Lord's throne with David's throne as having already taken place. It is for these reasons that Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 are regarded as the poetic pillars and the foundational entrances into the remainder of the content and argument of the Psalter. Thus, there are two groups of people, the wicked and the righteous, who responded completely differently to the Lord's law, and there is his Messiah. But let's begin to apply this thesis to books 1, 2, and 3. And by the way, it is book 3 I'm going to focus on, and it is Thursday's chapel you want to hear particularly, because it'll be Psalm 83, one of the great great final battles in the history of the world. Let's look at book 1, Psalm 3 through 41. All the Psalms in book 1 are attributed to David except Psalm 10, which completes the alphabetic acrostic of Psalm 9, which was attributed to David, and Psalm 33, which is a quasi-acrostic in that it has 22 verses, which is the amount of letters in Hebrew, but not arranged in alphabetic order. Since David is the anointed man of promise in the messianic plan of God, the distinctive role explains why his person is so central. Such a view is confirmed by the Apostle Peter in Acts 4:25, I wanted to introduce into this lecture some New Testament, because my students, all 58 years of my teaching the Old Testament, they have thought I didn't know about the New Testament. And they bring me Gospels of John, New Testaments, with Psalms. I got a whole closet full of them. And I've told them I've read the New Testament. And I like it. It reminds me of the old. So, remember we're in Acts 4, verse 25, where in response to the Jewish leaders who had threatened the disciples of our Lord, explained that God, quote, spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of his servant, our father David, end of quote, which he followed up with a quote from the second Psalm, and he attributed it to David, even though Psalm 2 was without a title, and he called it Psalm 2. So David's personal involvement in the construction of the Psalms in Book 1 can be seen in the fact that 32 of the 37 Psalms are attributed to David in Book 1, all have the singular personal pronoun I, or the like. As such, it is important to appreciate the fact that as the psalmist spoke of the Messianic King, he in a similar way spoke of those who loved Messiah and showed they wanted to walk with him. As Robertson put it, quote, as it fares with the Messianic King, so it fares with each member of the Messianic Kingdom, end of quote. Good quote. To illustrate his point, Robertson took up the discussion in Psalm 3. This psalm has David speaking the first person as he deals with the horrible, horrendous situation in which his own son Absalom led a coup against his father in order to seize the throne. Consequently, as David fared in his time of testing, so would the people of Israel fare. But the question that looms large here is, why was this incident placed as the first happening in the life of David in Book 1? Without a doubt, this attempted coup against David was a most agonizing situation for David. But how could that be of any help to those he hoped to minister to? This coup would affect David, but it did not appear to be directly related to those David was addressing in the scripture. David appeals to God's ancient word of promise to him and his line of heirs. But then he reminds the Lord of the promise he had made to him personally about the continuation of his house. But he would also, he strategically added that the dwelling place of the Lord would be in the midst of his people. The Lord would give to David this promise that would come not only to rescue him, but would be a deliverance to his people as well. Robertson moved from discussion of Psalm 3 to pointing out special attention to the role of Psalm 18 and 19, wherein two psalms, coupled by a messianic psalm with a law, Torah psalm, mirrored Psalm 1 and 2. Here is Robertson's point. The placement of Psalm 18 and 19 suggests an intentional arrangement of these two psalms so that the foundational or poetic pillars of Psalm 1 and 2 with their Torah and messianic emphasis could be highlighted in Book 1. five kingship psalms immediately appear after Psalm 18 and 19. What are they? Psalm 20, 21, 22, 23, 24. So from Psalm 3 to 17, not once did the Psalms use the messianic kingship terminology. However, after David was established as messianic king with the defeat of his enemies, including King Saul, all of a sudden, Psalm 18:50, which ends that block, announces, quote, "He gives his king great victories. He shows unfailing love to his anointed, to David and to his descendants forever," which begins a number of times when the language of the messianic kingship, which had not been used since Psalm 2, now appears, beginning with Psalm 20, verse 6, verse 9, Psalm 21, verse 1, verse 7, and so forth. But that was not all. Beside the use of messianic terminology, these five kingship psalms appear immediately, Psalm 20 through 24. These five psalms form what he calls a poetic pyramid. Psalm 20, 21 present the kingship of the Lord God, Messiah, and Psalm 23, 24 present Yahweh as king, and Psalm 22 is the pinnacle. My God, my God. By the way, read it that way in the church reading. Don't put the emphasis on the second part. It is my God, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. So the central psalm is Psalm 22. So while no psalm in 3 through 17 presents David as the anointed one or the king or the one who has won great victories, yet Psalm 18 and 19 do just that. Some may stumble over the fact that Psalm 23 depicts the Lord as shepherd and not as king. But that image also bears out his kingly status. What is true of the lack of references to Messiah's kingship in 3 through 17 is also true of the law of God, except for a single reference about God's law with regard to the wicked in Psalm 10, verse 5. Multiple terms for the law of God do not occur until after Psalm 19, which begins, you remember, with discussion of the creation of the whole world, and then, oh, how I love thy law. There is one more important contribution to the understanding of the structural role of Book 1. It is the four alphabetic acrostic psalms out of the total eight acrostic psalms that appear in the whole Book of Psalms. The significance of these acrostic poems is that they are related to the creation psalms and usually follow the creation psalm. Thus, there are only three creation psalms in Book 1 out of a total of eight. The creation psalm 8, it precedes the acrostic psalm 9 and 10, which is one psalm. The creation psalm 24, which precedes the acrostic psalm 25, and the creation psalm 33, which precedes the acrostic psalm 34. Such teaming up of a creation psalm with an acrostic psalm does not appear to be part of a random connection of text, but it was all done to fill out the key theological concept. Robertson, along with so many Reformed theologians, emphasized redemptive historical framework for interpreting the Bible, and especially the Old Testament. If this were not the only thing, I want to add that he missed one point, and that is the doctrine of creation, which supplies a third dominant theme beside redemptive historical, I would put the sovereign creational theme. in which the one coming as Redeemer is also simultaneously King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who will rule and reign forever. Therefore, to add to the picture Robertson has drawn for us, I would urge that the Book of Psalms has three, not 2 points of reference. Robertson stressed the principle of law, Psalm 1, Messiah, Psalm 2. I would add Psalm 8, Psalm 24, Psalm 33, the creation Psalms. Thus, the Psalter builds on the way of life found in the law, focused on Messiah, who created everything, and to whom all rule and all authority will be concluded after Messiah has provided redemption for all. So the conclusion to Book 1 is that Robertson suggests that Book 1 focused on confrontation, the animosity raised between two seeds, the way of the wicked and the way of the righteous. But as the Lord's anointed, David had experienced one struggle after another as he faced the opponents of God's kingdom. But the opponents were usually single-fold, individual nations. They will turn out in Book 3 to be international confederation, an alliance of nations for the first time. But David faced them individually. Book 2, I don't have time for some of your deeply in prayer that I would finish. So Book 2 is Psalm 42 to 72. It only has 31 Psalms, but it too has three introductory Psalms, 42 through 44, and then four Psalms on the Lord, Elohim. And I was going to do, why is it that if they prefer here in this book, Elohim, way over the number of times that Yahweh appears? But it is, he is addressing all the nations of the world. And then it's a summon to everyone from two intervening Psalms, 49 and 50. And then comes the second collection of the Davidic Psalms, of 51 to 71. Well, to tie this all up and to conclude, the Book of Psalms then is not a hodgepodge, a collection of what for the most part were isolated Psalms that are self-contained. Instead, they contain an intentional structure that embraces three foundational entry points into a continuing message of the book: the law, the Messiah, and the creational sovereignty over all persons and things. Great is the word of the Lord, and great is the anointed one in the line of David, and great is the rule and reign of the Lord our God, who is to come. What a wonderful Lord. What a wonderful book. And it has opened up a whole new series for me. Tomorrow morning, we'll go to Book 3, do a survey of Book 3. Thursday morning is the one not to miss. There is Psalm 83, and I'm going to talk about the great battle of 10 nations that surround Israel that are going to, for the first time, agree on anything. And that is, we've got to eradicate Israel from the face of the earth. Says so in the Psalm. And the Lord steps in and says, enough already. Then we'll conclude on Friday with Psalm 80, which talks about Jesus being the son of Joseph and being the son of David. How is that? And how is that indeed possible? thank you for your attention this morning, and may God help us as we continue to look at this part of his word. Shall we pray together? Thank you, our God, for the majesty of your person, the awesomeness of who you are, and the greatness with which you are now involved in moving everything toward the climax, and that you should be our Lord. We are so deeply grateful. So lead on, O King Eternal. Help us in every walk of life, and especially in days of preparation. Be strong, be gracious, and may we also see the nations coming as never before. May the nation of Israel, especially your chosen people from the beginning, may they respond finally in massive numbers. So grant great, great, great blessing. And for all these things, we give you thanksgiving and praise, for it's in your matchless name we pray. Amen. Amen.